What is going on live here on the Volumes YouTube page? Subscribe to the Volumes YouTube page. Subscribe to the Three and Out podcast with me. I'm John Middlekauff. Appreciate those of you watching that already have done that. And we do this every Monday and every Thursday. We record the bulk of the podcast live right here on YouTube. So let's dive into it. Okay, I wanted to start with Belichick because I've spent a lot of this week thinking about that game on Monday night. And if you've listened to the show for a while, I think you realize, like, I'm not breaking down guard play. I'm not breaking down, you know, secondary coverages, coverage units on special teams. That's not the show. And I think my overall viewing of sports reflects what I talk about here. I watch pro sports and definitely the highest level of college for legends, the best of the best. My favorite athlete, really there's two of them, but definitely of the last 20 years is Tiger Woods. And before that was Michael Jordan. Like, those are the type of guys I watch sports for. I don't watch for the overachieving guy who makes it that shouldn't have. If I wanted that, I'd go to a high school football game. I actually had a good one right down the street from my house last week, Folsom, who upset De La Salle. I watch pro sports for Steph Curry's, for Max Scherzer's, for Bill Belichick. And that's what I like talking about. And luckily, most of you, most sports fans are casual fans. And the weird part about someone like myself who's dedicated his life to working in football and now talking about it, I'm much closer to a casual fan than I am some diehard. I just consume a lot of it, and I made it my life's work. But I am not as into the weeds as some of these other shows. And listen, I've listened to a bunch of different stuff. It's just not for me. And, you know, most of it's not for you. I see some of their numbers, like McAfee. McAfee's a good example. I just saw he got $30 million a year. You watch Pat McAfee, like, he's talking to Aaron Rodgers. He's playing the hits. And that's what interests me. And luckily with Belichick, and there was some breaking news this week. Tiger Woods is playing in that little thing with his kid, which is really cool. And I say this all the time about Tiger. If you were worth, I mean, Tiger's worth like $1 billion. He just had his leg shattered. And from, I knew someone like secondhand that was on the scene. Clearly, if you just watch him limp around, his leg was mangled. Yet less than a year later, the dude's playing golf still. Like, what does the guy have to prove? You know, and a lot of people that watch football think, like, I could do it. I don't think you could. I tried it. I don't think you quite understand the addiction these men have. Tiger Woods, Belichick, I saw it firsthand with Andy Reid. They love the sport infinitely more than you think you love the sport. And I bet a lot of you probably love the sport a lot. These guys are addicts. And Belichick, who last year, let's face it, it was pretty ugly for his standards. He still went 7-9. He had a quarterback that couldn't pass, and he had a defense that led the league in opt-outs. And then this year, he somehow figures it out, and now he's 9-4 and in the driver's seat to get the number one overall seed. But I think part of the coolest part about talking about the best of the best, a Tiger Woods, a Tom Brady, a Bill Belichick, a Steph Curry, is they have these different moments along their career. And it's hard, like, until it ends, it's hard to put it all into context, but you know when you're watching it, you're like, that was pretty special right there. And listen, he has won bigger games clearly in his career than what happened on Monday night. He's won 6 Super Bowls as a head coach. He was a defensive coordinator for, you know, one of the more famous teams in league history. And even Parcells had said in the 30 for 30 documentary that Belichick was in full control of the game plan. I think they put the game plan in Canton. The one that he beat, won the K-Gun offense with against the Bills and one of the Walsh teams just to get to the Super Bowl. So Belichick has 8 Super Bowl rings that he's a major part of, right? But that moment on Monday night to throw the ball 3 times in the modern-day NFL, and really, and we talked about this on Monday's pod, one of the throws, Josh screamed at Mac for throwing the ball. They didn't want him to throw the ball. Listen, I don't know where to rank it I haven't watched every Patriot game over the last 21 years, but that is definitely a moment in time in his career that was very, very memorable. And that was a moment that kind of defines, and we talked about it a couple days ago, his willingness to do whatever it takes. I've been thinking about, like, if Tom Brady had been his quarterback, I don't know if the game would have looked that much different. Now, they clearly would have thrown it a couple more times, but they would have ran it given they were having success that many times. I don't know how many other coaches would have. It's in my lifetime. You know, it's just an incredible accomplishment. I also was thinking about this. One thing you do when you watch the Patriots this year, they are getting some huge contributions from guys that he signed as free agents. And for a long period of time, Belichick, definitely like the last half decade, Belichick has taken a lot of shit for not being a great drafter. And I do think sometimes when you're the head coach, you can be so close to things, it's hard to separate. Now, historically, he's been a great general manager. Look at the players he's acquired, he's drafted. You know, he gets credit for Tom Brady. Like, he gets credit for Rob Gronkowski. He gets credit for trading for Randy Moss. Like, he's made incredible moves as a general manager over his, like, he signed Gilmore to the most money he'd ever signed a free agent. Like, he's done incredible things. But his drafting in a vacuum has been very hit or miss lately, up until this year where it looks like he had a fantastic draft. But the years previously had struggled. And it hit me. He had never, you know, kind of dove into the deep end when it came to free agent signings. And it was understandable. He never wanted to pay a guy, because forever he had Tom Brady, who was always making under what he should have been making, and pay a guy who made equal or maybe even more than Tom was making. You bring that in the locker room, it would get weird. And the one time he kind of did it, Gilmore was immediately so elite, no one even cared. But it's pretty risky. One thing's pretty clear, though, looking at his team this year, Judon has been fantastic. Kendrick Bourne makes plays all over the place. The two tight ends are really, really good. Trent Brown, when he's been healthy, you see some of the clips from the other night of Trent Brown just mollywopping defenders, just destroying them. Belichick can isolate and tell you exactly who is good in the NFL. No one does it better on a weekly basis. The strengths and weaknesses of players, he gets it. If you think about moving forward with the Mac Jones, I would say, Bill, don't even waste. Use those picks to make trades for players in the league. Belichick's, you know, ability to sign guys and understand who is a really good player and who is going to fit on his team is actually a point of strength for him. And I don't think he's utilized it much over the years because of the financial constraints. And like I just said, he didn't want to screw up his locker room. Well, now he has a rookie quarterback who doesn't make that much money. He should utilize that benefit, not only free agency, but maybe use some of his draft capital to trade for players that are already in the league. Now, we've seen it in recent memory of Jalen Ramsey's, of Stephon Diggs, guys like that who might become available. You would say historically, Bill hasn't really done that, definitely with a high pick. I think he should delve into that water because I think that's a kind of a point that he can separate himself from because of his understanding of the league. Like, no one understands individual players better on a weekly basis, on a yearly basis, on a career basis than Belichick. We saw him on, you know, the top 100 players in league history. His ability to talk about guys' strengths and weaknesses, put their careers into context, he can do that with every guy in the NFL right now. To me, he should get more aggressive moving forward, big picture. He could build a team these next couple years that is just ready-made to kick ass. And I think what's going to be scary, if Mac can keep progressing, the Patriots are going nowhere. And we talk about Bill Belichick. I know he's 70 years old, but I don't think he's going anywhere either. So he's already a clear legend, arguably the greatest coach in the history of the sport and, you know, potentially top two or three in the history of sports. He could go on a little two or three-year run here where he's just a major, major factor. Now, are they going to go to the Super Bowl? I don't know. It's very, very difficult to go to the Super Bowl, even if you're the number one seed with a rookie quarterback. It just is, because it's hard to circumvent some of his weaknesses. And his weaknesses might just be as simple as just experience. And, you know, I know he had experience last year leading a team to the national championship. He's got to play immediately right away. He's already got to play in some big games. But eventually, like, as a quarterback in the NFL in big games, you got to make plays. Third and eight, third and nine, third and 11. Like, that just happens in playoff games. But I do think the Patriots, whether they, you know, win a playoff game this year, get bounced in the second round, you know, host the AFC championship and lose it, get to the Super Bowl, whatever, are kind of built, especially if he doubles down on what he's realized that he's already really good at, they could be a factor for a while. A couple other teams going into this weekend that are pretty desperate. Start with the Raiders. They're, depending on where you look, a 9.5, 10-point underdog against Kansas City. There are already rumors circulating, and it makes sense, that Mark Davis might blow this bad boy up, right? His coach is already gone. His acting general manager, who's in charge, the only reason he's there is because Gruden hired him. Let's face it, like, Mayock wasn't probably getting a general manager job without John Gruden. And then under Mayock's watch, it's not no fault of his own. A couple weeks later after Gruden got fired, the Henry Rugg situation happens. They're not going to make the playoffs. Assuming they get their ass kicked this week in Kansas City, which I don't think you can easily do just because they beat them last year. But last year, if I remember correctly, Henry Ruggs had a touchdown in Kansas City. It's going to be very, very difficult. So if Mark Davis chooses to blow this thing up for like the third time in his tenure as the owner since Al Davis died, there's a rumor circulating that I saw that actually makes a little sense. We see this in college football, and we'll get into Mario and Marcus Freeman and some things I saw in their press conferences in a little bit. But it's hard with college football. When a coach leaves after a championship game, because of the recruiting calendar, everything can get a little off. Right. So like right now, Oregon doesn't have a coach. Well, all these recruits are committing, signing days in like a week, that first signing day. It's just kind of it's not ideal. But in the pros, if you're going after a college coach, the Raiders' last game is January 9th. So even if Jim Harbaugh was in the national championship, and yes, I just said Jim Harbaugh, that game's the following day. So if you fired everyone on the 10th, Jim Harbaugh's playing that night. Hell, and even if he got bounced the first night against Georgia, that's a week ago. He's not going anywhere. He's already signed in his class. Jim Harbaugh and Mark Davis, when Jed York mutually departed with his coach, had contact. They talked. Now, it was a weird spot. Michigan was going full court press. They offered him an enormous contract. The Raiders weren't really viewed as, you know, Khalil Mack and Derek Carr had just finished their rookie season. The team was financially not in a great spot. It was kind of a toxic place. And I give Jack Del Rio some credit. He got the job and kind of got them on the right foot. Well, now they're in Vegas, where in theory the money should be flowing. Their practice facility is incredible. And Mark Davis has just shown with John Gruden, he's willing to pay a premium for coaches. He was actually ahead of his time. You see some of the coaching money that's getting thrown around now for college guys? Mark Davis was doing that 5-6 years ago with John Gruden. Right? I mean, he kind of set the bar. Like, that's the new contract. You want to get a sweet coach, you got to offer 8 to 10 years at $10 million plus. And I do think that Mark Davis would be crazy to not reach out to Jim Harbaugh because the team has a couple defensive ends. They have a quarterback on the roster that they need to figure out what to do with. Derek Carr next year will be going into the last year of his contract. But if you are going to detonate this thing, which I think is probably the right move, you can't just entrust Mike Mayock, who's been a general manager in the league for 3 years and a lifetime TV guy, to just resurrect your franchise and let him hire the coach. Then I think Jim Harbaugh would make a lot of sense. And obviously Jim Harbaugh had the most successful year in his career so far at Michigan. So if he were to win a national championship, I actually think he has a pretty easy out. He said, listen, I came back, you cut my salary in half, I gave all this money to all these people that lost their money during COVID, I'm a good guy, and now I'm a winner, I've brought you everything, I've kind of filled the cupboards for you guys with players and talent, I got the brand back, take it from here, right? Or maybe he just finds himself being very loyal, I don't know. But we've always talked about Jim, this is the longest Jim Harbaugh has ever been in a place in his coaching career, by a pretty wide margin now. Every game that goes by keeps separating because the longest before that was 4 years. And listen, Jim loves his money. He just took a huge pay cut. I don't know if he's resentful or petty at Michigan. Not saying they were wrong because he hadn't been producing. But to me, if you are going to blow it up to meet Jim Harbaugh for the Raiders and their brand, I think it just aligns and makes perfect sense. So if the Raiders get their ass kicked this week, which they should, playing the Chiefs, you know, a team that's just one of the hottest teams in the league, and then their season just kind of unravels, again, as it should. They're just not good enough. I don't know if this coach is any good. They just got some problems. Don't be shocked when Jim Harbaugh's name keeps coming up with the Raiders search. And the other team that I think is just facing a little desperation is the Brownies. And listen, they were a team that coming into the season, you didn't have to be John Schneider or Jason Light to look at their roster and go, damn, this has got to be one of the best rosters in the league. This is a team that should win 12, 13 games. And right now they are, you know, fighting for their playoff lives this weekend against the Ravens. They've had a bunch of injuries. Mainly their quarterback has been a shell of himself because of those injuries. Now, as of recording this on Thursday, he practiced on Monday, he practiced on Wednesday. They're coming off a bye. It's the first time he's been healthy, you know, healthier in a while, because it's hard to get healthy when you're playing every week. Well, they have this bye. Maybe he gets his body under him a little bit. But if you lose this game against the Ravens, and let's face it, the Ravens aren't that good right now, what do you do if you're the Browns? You've already picked up his fifth-year option, so he's going to be on the team next year. But this is not the general manager that drafted Baker Mayfield. This is not the head coach that pounded the table for Baker Mayfield. Now, Stefanski has proven that he can win with quarterbacks like this, right? I think he could win with Case Keenum. He won with Kirk Cousins. He could win with a healthy Baker Mayfield. But the big, you know, kind of the elephant in the room is, and Lamar hasn't signed his contract yet, but he's going to get a huge contract. Josh Allen, Lamar Jackson, are we giving this guy huge money? Well, if you can't make the playoffs, and a big reason is because he's terrible, like, let's face it, Baker's not getting extended. These are two Ivy League guys. They're really wired. Stefanski's a football coach, but I do think the way they think, definitely Andrew Berry, is a little, you know, like baseball analytical. And I mean that in a positive way, you know, valuing what's the cost we got to pay, you know, given the production, can we piecemeal this together? Now, unlike baseball where you can platoon players, it's much different with quarterbacks, right? You can't go cheap on a quarterback and then complain when you don't win. But they inherited this situation. And last year he was good, so I don't blame them for rolling it back. But I do think this season, and if you lose games like this, divisional games to a team that is not going away. Like, if you think about the Ravens, this might be their low point. They had a million injuries. Even Lamar's banged up. It's just been a weird season, and they're still going to win probably 10 or 11 games. That's their low point, right? The Bengals, whether they make the playoffs this year or not, it's pretty clear their core of young players is going nowhere. And number one, they have a quarterback. So if you're the Browns, part of it is not just the big picture of the AFC, which looks pretty good. Chiefs are going nowhere. The Colts now have a quarterback. Titans just have a good infrastructure. The Bills are going through a rough spot and they ain't going anywhere. Patriots are here to stay. Like, I do think you need to do some introspection. Kind of same thing with the Raiders. Like, the AFC is going to be good for a while. You need a top flight coach, which I think the Browns have. I think Stefanski's good. And you need a good quarterback. Without the good quarterback, and when I say, like, Baker's good enough if he's making $8, $9 million. He's not if you're going to pay him $35 million. Especially if this is probably closer to the Baker than what we saw last year. Is there some middle ground? I don't know. But if he gets smoked this weekend, which I don't have a great feel for this game, I would tend to bet the Ravens. I do think you have to start questioning, what are these two Ivy League guys that run the Browns going to do with their young quarterback? And then some other news, Kayvon Thibodeau, the star pass rusher for the Oregon Ducks, who's one of, I think, the biggest recruit Oregon's ever landed, who is going to be a lock top three pick. I think the number one pick is really between him and Aiden Hutchinson, the star pass rusher for the Michigan Wolverines. One problem for Thibodeau, and it's no fault of his own, the moment they lost to Utah, they're no longer going to the Rose Bowl. Then his coach leaves, so he declares to go pro. He's not going to play in the bowl game against Oklahoma. Now, he has 3 years, a body of work. He doesn't need to do anything. I could say the same thing for Hutchinson. The problem for Thibodeau is going to be Hutchinson might have been slightly above him anyway. And when I think Dan Campbell, if you watch number 97 at Michigan, it's hard not to think like, yeah, I can't imagine Dan Campbell loving this guy. When I think Dan Campbell, I think number 97 at Michigan. And then potentially he has two more games, because obviously he's going to play in his bowl games because he's playing in the playoffs. What if Hutchinson gets to play in multiple games against the two best SEC teams and racks up three or four sacks? What if he has a couple against Georgia and then a couple against Alabama? I don't see how he wouldn't solidify himself as the number one overall pick. It makes a lot of sense. Not that this matters in pro football, but he plays at Michigan. The Lions are going to have the number one overall pick. They're in desperate need for defensive players. Honestly, it already feels, like I said, like he's going to be the guy. But if he has any, there's going to be 20 plus million people watching these playoff games. The ratings are going to be out. Michigan, Georgia, I would imagine that game is going to be one of the most highly rated playoff games in the history of the playoffs. And he's going to be one of the prime guys we're going to be talking about. And the camera's going to be on him. He has a couple sacks. They upset that. They win that game. I think they're a touchdown underdog. And then they get Bama in the natty. You're going to look at a guy that earned himself a lot of money coming back for a senior season and is going to end up going number one overall. A couple other NFL stories that I just thought were interesting. Andrew Whitworth, who I'm just a big fan of. I mean, I've been watching his game since he was with the Bengals. He's 40 years old. 40 years, starting at left tackle at 40 years old. What an incredible accomplishment. Now, part of it is like, you just get incredible genetics to be that big and that, you know, graceful just to be able to play tackle. But then the element of luck slash toughness to be able to last that long in the trenches and still be good enough to start on a good team, that you're just not going to see that very often. Remember when we had that, I think it was like 10 years, Joe Thomas had never missed a snap, and then he hurt his shoulder and it ended his season, and I think he retired a little later after. Like, you just don't see this stuff that often. Even in a day and age where 40 is probably the new, you know, even for offensive linemen, 40 ain't the new 30. 40 is maybe the new 37. But it's very, very difficult to start at that position where, unlike guard or center, I got to cover some ground. I'm going up against powerful guys, speed guys, outside linebackers. They blitz defensive backs off that side. Like, you got to be a top-flight athlete on top of being a top-flight tough guy, on top of just having, you know, not having major injuries to overcome it. So it's just, that's just a cool little nugget. Extra point rate in the NFL right now is the lowest since 1979. And go back to Belichick. Do you remember several years ago, he was the guy pounding the table for not having the extra point field goal at the two-yard line? He said, move it back. Make it a legitimate field goal. So there is some human element of that, even if it's not, because I think before it was like 99.9%. Just adding that slight variable, and then it gets some people to think about going for two. Because let's face it, added a little excitement in the NFL. When I remember when it was, I don't want to say controversial, but when it was being discussed, whether they were going to move the extra point back, I'm like, who even cares? It has been a hit. That worked. Belichick, genius. Jamal Adams, out for the season, injured. I think he hurt his shoulder. I know Pete basically said that, like, they don't not only regret the trade, they don't regret the trade. They think he's been fantastic, made a bunch of plays. It's been a disaster. If they had a do-over, they would press the reset button so fast your head would spin. I don't blame them. They made a bold move. Because Pete, the head coach, is ultimately the boss of the organization, and it's just backfired. Now, I don't blame – it didn't backfire because he got injured, even if he hadn't got injured. He's just not good enough to trade for two ones and a two. And it's just been a trade that ultimately might cost, you know, this kind of – this dynasty is the wrong word. You know, the tenure of the group to come to an end. Now, it's not just because of this move. But I do think this move, this short-sighted move, is going to be symbolic to why it all ends. And then, and last but not least, is the Burrow finger. It's just something to keep an eye on. Because the AFC playoffs pretty wide open. I still think the Colts are going to get in. I think the Chargers are going to get in. And I think if the Bengals lose this week to the 49ers and Burrow's hands messed up, like the Bengals have no shot if Joe is injured. That ain't going to happen. So that pains me. I'm a big Joe Burrow guy. I want him to be healthy. But you hurt a finger. We've seen what it have done to a couple guys in the league. I mean, we saw what it did to Russell. He's been a shell of himself, you know, since that injury. So I know it's a little – I don't think it's mallet finger, but he dislocated it. It clearly is probably pretty painful. A couple college things. I would recommend, if you just got 7-8 minutes, just watch Mario Cristobal's introduction press conference. I didn't watch him taking questions, but just him introducing himself to the Miami, you know, community, to his team, to the media, and just kind of selling himself. And I'll be honest, I haven't watched Mario speak that much, but when I watched that introductory press conference, I came away thinking, I get it. I understand. I understand why this guy's such a good recruiter. Now, part of it was his passion for that, university. Obviously, his connection of playing there, what it means for him. It's hard to fake that. Like, you can't fake his passion for the University of Miami. But I also think, and he mentioned this, people act like he was just ready to jump ship. I actually think he was all in at Oregon. Not that anyone is saying anything otherwise, but he was in the deep end with Oregon. And I do believe, watching him talk, there are two jobs. Like, Oregon had themselves a coach who was not looking to leave. Two jobs he would have left for: Alabama, if Saban had retired, or this job. Other than that, he wasn't going to leave Oregon. You know why? He didn't need to. They were landing top 7-8 recruiting classes every year in a conference that no one was doing that. Now, Lincoln probably will now that he's here. But part of him going to Miami, you feel the passion. I think he feels obligated to fix a place that changed his life. But his ability to go into these recruits' homes, I understand why all these guys have been committing to him in Oregon. Like, it's like, I get it. I see it. He's got like a panache, a swag to him that it's like, yeah. Now, he's not a great in-game coach. He's not Mr. Schematic. But in college, if you can be an elite recruiter, let's face it. Now, Urban Meyer, when he was in college, was a better schematic guy. But he had offensive coordinators calling the plays. Urban wasn't play caller. He just became the best recruiter in the country, him and Saban, right? It's kind of what Kirby's doing. Like, Kirby's not calling the plays anymore. Dan Lanning is calling the plays on defense. So if you can become, and I think Mario can become this, a top two or three recruiter in the country, especially at Miami, when all the, like, it's going to, his floor, listen, I don't think Mario is ever going to be some elite college coach. When I say elite, I just mean, like, I think it's going to be difficult for him to win national championships. But his floor, because of his recruiting ability, like, I think they could win 10 games by, like, year two. Now, it's going to be natural. Everyone will be excited. If he has back-to-back, like, 10-win seasons, people will get antsy. Like, why can't he make the playoffs? Why can't he beat Clemson or whatever? But I'm telling you, he's going to turn that bad boy around much faster than I think people realize. I would imagine they're competitive next year, but they will be good in 2 years. He's just too elite of a recruiter. I'm telling you, watch the press conference and you come away thinking, yeah, I'd probably commit to Mario Cristobal. I watched Marcus Freeman, who, at 35 years old, I'm older than the guy. It's remarkable to see his maturity level and him talk at his press conference. He is a very, very impressive guy. But I also had this thought, like, it could go two ways. I think whenever you take over a program that is already really good and has a ton of players on the roster, you're inexperienced as a coach. Like Lincoln Riley several years ago, you can learn through it because your talent is so strong. Like, would Lincoln Riley have become Lincoln Riley if I put his first job at Arkansas or I put his first job at Duke? I think we can all agree, and I think he'd agree if he was sitting here with a beer, yeah, probably I wouldn't have, I might not have dominated right off the bat. So he gets to inherit a program which is loaded with NFL players. Even if they're flawed relative to Ohio State and Alabama and Clemson, they're still better than 98% of other programs. And he's a really impressive guy, and I'm watching him talk. He is going to recruit harder than Brian Kelly. And Brian Kelly was doing a damn good job at Notre Dame. This guy is going to go after players that Mario, Kirby, Nick, and Ryan Day are going after, which we'll see if they have success doing that, but he's going to, on top of the guys that he knows he can get. The one question I have is, for every Lincoln Riley that gets to inherit this really good program, sometimes you see, now it was different because they got sanctioned, but like when Lane got the job at USC, and sometimes you see it with younger coaches, it can just be difficult. Like, you have a couple difficult losses, something weird just happens in your program. Because the one thing every coach always talks about, and it makes sense, you can never be prepared for things that end up coming your way. Because when you're like the offensive coordinator, the defensive coordinator, let's say if you were Marcus Freeman last year, the defensive coordinator, not that this is going to happen that often at Notre Dame, but a starting offensive guard gets a DUI. You don't have to deal with that. It's not your unit. It's not your guy. I'm not saying that it doesn't impact you. You don't know the player, but it's just not really your problem. That's the head coach's problem. That's the offensive coordinator's problem. And it's really the offensive line coach's problem. But when you're the head coach, if that happens, a guy gets DUI, a guy gets in trouble, a guy's ineligible, That's your problem, whether it's an offensive guy, whether it's a defensive guy, whether it's a special teams guy. And I'm just watching him going, this guy's 35. You know, the difference is now he's worked for Fickell for 3 years and then he went to Brian Kelly. Lincoln Riley had worked for Bob Stoops for several years as the offensive coordinator. Now, it was only a couple, but to me, if he had been there a couple years, he would have, you know, a lot of good insight into the way Brian Kelly ran his program. Now, like I said, he did work for Lou Fickell for a couple years. It's just going to be tough. It is not easy to be a head coach. And I think next year they play Ohio State. They play Clemson. The thing at Notre Dame, right, like I think in Lincoln's first year, boom, they made the playoffs, right? So it just gives everyone thinks of your credibility at a much higher level than really you might have been that, like, you were going to be what you were going to be. But his team, and he had a stud NFL quarterback. Now, if Marcus Freeman makes the playoffs next year, he'll get a contract extension. He'll be a made man. What if they go 9-3? Then all of a sudden it's like, are we taking a step back? Whether that's fair or not. And then, you know, that's the thing about taking over the elite of the elite programs. Like, ultimately, when Lincoln took over Oklahoma, you had to be going 10-2 minimum. You know, really, they wanted 11-1, 12-1 competing for the playoffs. Right? You can't just come to Notre Dame and have like a solid year 8-4. People be starting asking themselves, can this guy coach? So I'm rooting for him. Again, his maturity at that age, 6 kids, blows me away. But it might be a little more difficult than we think. And last but not least, Jeff Tedford became the head coach at Fresno State. And listen, I GA'd at Fresno State. I don't think it can be overstated how lucky a non-Power 5 program is like Fresno State to have an alumni in Jeff Tedford who, despite having several like heart attacks, refuses to quit coaching football because they shouldn't be able to hire a guy this good. I mean, they should. Jeff Tedford should be at Oregon. Jeff Tedford took Cal, which is, I think, the best public university, not in America, in the world, the number one public university in the world, and turned it into like an elite football school, was producing multiple first rounders every year, found Aaron Rodgers, Marshawn Lynch and DeSean Jackson would ever end up at Cal in a million years if Jeff Tedford hadn't been alive. And for Fresno State to get this guy, they are very, very lucky. And this, when I talk about football addicts, like I'm talking addicts, this guy had to have surgery on his heart. This guy had a bad ticker. He had to quit coaching multiple times because of his heart. He's 60 years old. He's a multimillionaire. And he just refuses to stop. He just will not stop coaching. Me, you, most of us at that age with some health issues, like, I'm done. He just can't stop. As a Fresno State fan, excited to have him on board, and the program should feel very, very lucky that Tedford is just a football addict and loves the program. Have a great day. Adios. See you.